Welcome to the APGO Basic Science Objective video about placentation. The objectives for this video are to understand the role of embryonic syncytiotrophoblastic and cytotrophoblastic cells in placental development, describe the layers of the chorion and how the fetal placental development affects the maternal surface, appreciate the basic functions of the placenta, be able to counsel a patient regarding her risk factors for a suspected placenta previa or accreta, and the subsequent impact on delivery, and understand the possible pathophysiology related to the development of placenta previa or accreta. All right, before you can appreciate obstetrics, you need to understand the development of the placenta, the most overlooked part of pregnancy. During the second week of gestation, the primary villi develop, which is the first stage of placental formation. The trophoblastic stem cells, the outer syncytiotrophoblasts, and the inner cytotrophoblasts form finger-like extensions into the maternal decidua, also known as the maternal uterine wall. At week 3, the secondary villi form. During this time, the extraembryonic mesoderm grows into the villi and covers the entire surface of the chorionic sac. During the fourth week, the tertiary villi form. This week, mesenchyme differentiates into blood vessels and forms an arteriocapillary network, fuses with placental vessels, and develops connecting stalks. The stem or anchoring villi are formed as extravillous cytotrophoblastic cells and attached to maternal tissue. Branched or terminal villi grow from the sides of the stem villi. In the third trimester, the terminal villi emerge from the proliferation of the trophoblastic cells. They are induced by capillary coiling during the growth of fetal capillaries within the mature villi. At the base of the villi, the placental arteries and veins pass through the chorionic plate. Terminal villi serve as the region of main gas and nutrient exchange. They are surrounded by maternal blood in the intervilla spaces. There are four layers separating maternal and fetal blood: syncytial trophoblast, cytotrophoblast, villi connective tissue, and fetal capillary endothelium. Vascular endothelial growth factor, or VEGF, drives two main phases of development in pregnancy. Initially, the cytotrophoblast is the cellular stimulus to vasculogenesis and angiogenesis. Later, the Hofbauer cells, placental macrophages of the mesenchymal origin, and stromal cells take over the stimulation of blood vessel development. The fibrinoid layer exists in two forms within the extracellular matrix. Fibrin-type fibrinoid is a maternal blood clotting product which replaces degenerating syncytiotrophoblasts. Matrix-type fibrinoid is secreted by invasive extravillous trophoblastic cells. The fibrinoid layer, or nidibook's layer, is thought to present excessively deep implantation, and the loss of this layer may lead to abnormal placentation invasion. Now let's pause, think, and apply. Think fast! The trophoblast consists primarily of two layers. What are these layers, and how do they contribute to the fetal or maternal surface of the chorion? The outer layer of the trophoblast is the syncytiotrophoblast, and after implantation, is replaced by fibrinoid extracellular matrix to form Nidibook's layer between the chorion and the decidualized endometrial surfaces. The inner cytotrophoblast stimulates fetal vasculogenesis in the chorion. Now that we've gone through placental development, let's look at some clinical implications.
The placenta has four main functions:
prevent fetal allograft rejections, metabolism, and transport and endocrine production. There are several risk factors for abnormal placental development: increasing parity, increasing maternal age, infertility treatments, previous abortion, previous uterine surgery such as dilation and curettage, cesarean section or myomectomy, maternal smoking, maternal cocaine use, male fetus, or non-white race of the mother. Let's look at two types of placental pathology a little closer. The pathogenesis of placenta previa is unknown. One hypothesis is that previous surgeries or fetal implantation leads to areas of suboptimal vascularized decidua. This promotes movement of trophoblasts to the lower uterine cavity. Another theory is that a large placenta, such as with multiples, increases the probability that the placenta will encroach or cover the internal os.
A special type of previa is a vasoprevia. In this case, fetal blood vessels from the placenta or the umbilical cord cross the internal cervical os.
These aberrant vessels result from filamentous cord insertions and bilobed or succinturate lobed placentas. Placental bleeding can be devastating sequelae of placental previa. Uterine contractions or gradual cervical change apply shearing forces to the inelastic placental site, resulting in a partial detachment. Digital vaginal exams and penetrative intercourse can also cause similar disruptions. Bleeding in a previa is mainly maternal, while a vasa previa bleeding is mainly fetal. Another major placental pathology is placenta accreta. This results from abnormal placental implantation in which anchoring placental villi attach to the myometrium rather than the decidua, resulting in an adherent placenta. Placenta accreta is a consequence of abnormal adherence and absence of the decidua basalis. The incidence is higher in women with prior cesarean section. Over 80% are associated with a disruption in Nidaboc's layer. Placenta increta occurs when the placenta grows in to the uterine muscle, but does not penetrate the serosa. This accounts for about 15% of all abnormal implantation cases. Finally, in a placenta percreta, the placenta penetrates both the myometrium and the serosa. This accounts for 5% of all cases and is the most morbid. The causes of placenta accreta are unknown, but may be related to defective decidualization from prior surgeries or anatomic factors. This is supported by observation that 80% of these cases occur in women with a history of a prior cesarean section, dilation and curettage, or myomectomy. Wow, I have to admit I never really gave the placenta much thought, especially not the clinical impact of the placental development. I wonder if I will get to put this didactic to use soon. Now let's pause, think, and apply. Think fast. A 30-year-old, Gravita 3, Para 2002, at 30 weeks gestation, and a history of two prior cesarean deliveries, presents with hematuria and sonographic evidence of an anterior placenta in the lower uterine segment. She is told she will possibly need a bladder resection at the time of delivery. Name the type of abnormal placentation described, and briefly describe the histopathology. The patient likely has placenta percreta, which occurs when the anchoring villi penetrate the myometrium and uterine serosa, and possibly adjacent organs, in this case, the bladder wall. Theoretically, this may happen due to defective vascular remodeling of the uterine scar, or partial or complete dehiscence of a previous hysterotomy. I have your ultrasound report. The fetal anatomy does not show any signs of concerns, but we should talk about your placenta a little. At this point, we think you have placenta previa. We will repeat imaging at the start of the third trimester to see if it has resolved. Oh, what are the chances that the placenta will move? The more the placenta extends over the os, and the more interior it is situated, the more likely it will be previa at delivery. Although our models are not good, if the placenta extends over the os by 15 to 25 millimeters, the likelihood of previa at delivery is about 20%. Contrast that with someone whose placenta is more than 25 millimeters across the os, their likelihood of a previa at delivery is over 40%. Our biggest concern, if the previa does not resolve, is maternal hemorrhage. However, we can start to address that further once we get closer. Oh, that sounds great. For now, I'll let you know if I have any vaginal bleeding, and we can reevaluate as you recommend. Thanks so much. Boy, am I glad I reviewed my placental physiology with Dr. Smith. This concludes the APGO Basic Science video on abnormal placentation. You should now understand the role of embryonic syncytiotrophoblastic and cytotrophoblastic cells in placental development, be able to describe the layers of the chorion, appreciate the basic functions of the placenta, and understand the basic pathophysiology of placenta previa or accreta.